As a result of the market volatility, equity mutual funds have been facing the heat. Returns have contracted for several equity funds across categories. However, gold funds and select international funds have seen a substantial outperformance in the last 3 to 6 months. To discuss this further, I'm joined by Firoz Aziz of Anand Rathi Wealth Management. Thanks very much, Firoz, for joining me on the show. So, as I was saying, I mean, we've seen a turnaround as far as international and gold funds are concerned in the last 3 to 6 months. But before getting into that, how would you compare the global environment versus the Indian environment at this point?
See, I think from a global perspective, global is a very large investment scope. But if you look at emerged markets to India, I think Indian equities have a large potential to outperform them because I think from a global context perspective, relatively, our economy is significantly better poised. 2 years back, whatever the macroeconomic problems were there for in India have got resolved very well. And that's not being focused upon. As soon as some degree of news flow stops coming in from the globe, then the Indian capital markets will actually have a revival.
Okay.
So net, the point I'm trying to make is over the next 2 years, 3 years, there will be a significant outperformance if you look at larger indices between these two portions of the world. And that's India will outperform. That's our opinion.
Okay, right. So if we compare the three-year returns of international funds, they are relatively much less than the equity funds, that diversified equity or across the board equity Indian funds. But in the last 3 to 6 months, we've seen a significant outperformance of certain international funds as well as gold funds. Now, we'll address gold funds separately, but as far as international funds are concerned, how do you see that really playing out going forward?
See, I personally think there's a strong negative correlation between these global funds and the Indian funds. From an asset allocation perspective, having some degree of international funds makes sense from a portfolio creation perspective.
Okay.
If you're standalone looking at the merit of each of them, both have space to fit into your jigsaw puzzle of a portfolio.
Right.
But I think they act as a good non-correlated asset classes. Now coming to your pointed question of what do you see for the next 6-8 months from these international funds, I think the relative outperformance would converge, and I don't think the relative outperformance would be there on the global side.
Okay.
In fact, this is the time over the next 6-8 months where the Indian funds will catch up and recover some degree of this underperformance.
Okay.
So if you have larger allocation there, we generally suggest to our clients that you've saved yourself 5-10% in terms of underperformance. Now you move to Indian funds and you'll make sure that this whole bit of Indian fund rally also would be a part of your portfolio.
Okay. And what about gold funds as far as gold? Because gold funds have been significant outflows, you know, for the last several months. But again, performance-wise, it has seen a big improvement in the past few months as well. How should one look at those funds?
See, first analyzing why is that differential? Because I personally feel that gold always is a safe haven. And there's huge flight of capital. Whenever there's risk aversion, people move their monies from capital markets to gold. And that's happened over the last 1 year, is why you see Nifty and gold has a performance difference of almost about 30%. So that's a very, very large difference. So in my opinion, this difference again has a large potential to converge. You should move your gold fund monies into equities because there's a 30% outperformance, which is it is the one of the largest over the last 35 years. The difference between in a one calendar year gold and Nifty giving these kind of divergent returns is an exception.
Okay, so what is the recommendation, as in how much of gold should one have in their portfolio right now?
See, there are two categories of people, the ones who already have gold in their portfolio. If they have gold in their portfolio to the extent of 10-15-20%, next 1-2 years could be a very good time frame to bring it to negligible levels from the next 2 years perspective. That's for somebody who has taken the benefit of the gold's sustenance and not falling.
Okay.
For somebody who's creating a portfolio today, I would recommend about 10% in gold. Because once US dollar also has some degree of stress, gold appreciates.
Okay.
And that becomes a good global hedge as well as Indian equities hedge.
Right. So for somebody who wants to invest in international funds, you've got several funds. You've got commodity linked funds, funds which have an exposure to emerging markets. How should one decide where to allocate the money?
Correct. Like you rightly pointed out, the first point is the region which the global fund focuses on. You have 5 categories in the region classification: US, Europe, China, Japan, and Asia. These are the 5 mutual fund categories which are available. In that, I would say that sticking on to US equities over the next 3 years would be a sensible thing to do, because it's one of the few economies which is actually showing revival, due to which Fed was also looking at interest rate hikes. So I think that's the only emerging economy from an equity perspective would I take a bet on.
Okay.
So if you move on to the next method of selection, very importantly, there are two categories of funds. One where you're creating a new fund. There is another which actually feeds into a very old fund. Like there is a Franklin US feeder fund, which is feeding monies from India into a fund which has been existing for 20, 25 years. Mm. That will actually not be a very good idea, because the investor set and the psyche is very different, and the objective would be very different. On the contrary, there's an ICICI US blue chip fund. It's not a feeder fund. The money gets managed only for the Indian mutual fund industry.
So Feroz, you're talking about US-based funds. I'm going to throw in the political angle here. We've got the presidential elections coming up.
Absolutely.
And of course, there's a fear of sorts that Donald Trump might actually become president.
Absolutely.
But what kind of an impact do you see that having? I know it's a very small trickle-down effect as far as people investing in international funds are concerned. But nonetheless, what kind of an impact would that the elections really have as far as investments, people's exposure to U.S. investments are concerned?
See, definitely, from a short-term perspective, these are very, very important milestones when it comes to news flows. But when you're looking at the largest economy in the country, in the world, and you're looking at 10% of your total portfolio's exposure, I don't think you should get too distracted and defer your investment decisions on the basis of U.S. elections, especially because you're not speaking about Indian equities, where 60% of one's money could be in Indian equities. But if you're speaking about U.S., you're anyway speaking about a smaller quantum of 10-15% of one's portfolio at the outset, but the maximum would be about 15%. So I don't think you should wait it out. Of course, it's going to have a short-term dampening impact, like you just mentioned.
Right. So as of now, for somebody who is looking to diversify across various asset classes and all of that, how would you compare Indian equities versus international funds?
See, if you actually on a scale of 1 to 10, I would rate Indian equities to 8-9, and other emerging countries' equities at 4-5, and some countries like China. Maybe we have two funds which are the Mirai Fund House, which focuses on China. They, after some more time of stability coming in, I would say, being a contrarian and using China's dip to buy into Chinese capital markets over the next 3-4 months to actually see further drops in the NAV would be a smart thing to do.
Right. Feroz, digressing a little bit, we've seen mutual fund flows come down significantly as of Feb. We had highs of 8,000 crores equity inflows, which has now come down to 1,500 odd crores this in Feb. Do you think that, you know, it's been coming down since December really, but do you think that's a trend that's going to continue, or do you think it was sort of a one-off thing that we saw and, you know, the faith will come back slowly?
See, the domestic investor psyche is a little different. And I personally think there are two reasons for this dip. One is, of course, people are waiting on the sidelines for the budget on 29th February. So the entire month, I don't think large allocations went into equity. That was one prime reason why February would almost be the least month if you go historically as well. So it's a trend that February, because the budget's at the month end, February generally has lesser net mobilizations. And to top it all, Feb was one of the worst months, where your closing of the month was at 6980 of Nifty.
Right.
So coupled with these, that's why they're dropped. So coming back to your question whether it will revive, in my opinion it will. And the Indian psyche is that once the market moves up 6-8%, they get comforted that the bottom is already discovered, and then people jump in. That's what, when I have been interacting with people in March, there has been huge propensity to invest in equities.
Right. All right, Feroz, on that hopeful note, we'll leave it there. Thanks so much for joining in. All right, time for a quick break. We'll come back and talk about the Knight Frank Wealth Report. Stay tuned.